Romance blossomed in the back row where kisses turned into marriages that endure to this day. And up on the screen as well, where screen idols gave audiences heart flutters and memories that endure to this day. The simple suburban cinema, the movie house that has enjoyed quite a resurgence over the past decade or so, but now under threat. Extra's Tina Altieri reports the little single screeners are getting the squeeze from distributors.
Remember that famous place?
Peyton Place.
Remember the famous line?
Frankly, lady, I don't give a damn.
If you remember watching them on the silver screen as new releases, chances are you huddled or snuggled in these independent picture houses. The single screen cinemas now facing extinction because of tough distributors' regulations.
They just don't want us.
Called No Share, the big-time film distributors dictate screening times of selected movies at small cinemas. For up to 4 weeks, no other movies allowed to share the silver screen spotlight at that particular venue. If the No Share movie is strictly a box office hit, like Paul Mercurio's Superseller, then a four-week solo stint is nothing for small cinema owners to complain about. But what happens when the new flick is a flop?
If you lock in for a four-week No Share film, such as Sister Act, which, you know, that's what it is, and it doesn't perform, then you have a problem.
The restriction of no-share movies is not a new one. Film distributors introduced it a couple of years ago. Only now, cinema owners claim the restriction is being imposed on more movies more often, bringing these independent movie houses to a tragic finale.
I don't think they want us around anymore. We're a thorn in their side, and we all run very good theatres with very good sound and very comfortable and at cheaper prices of admission.
From the distributor's point of view, of course, he wants to get every dollar he can for his film. Each print costs money, and of course he's looking to maximise the return for himself.
Ron Regan's Asta is one of a handful of barely surviving single-screen cinemas. So tough the restrictions, this movie buff is being forced to go twin, constructing a sister screen in the Asta, not only to give cinema-goers variety, but to keep this Art Deco delight financially afloat when only one movie can be shown on one screen.
I think the one-screen cinemas are basically doomed.
It doesn't make sense because in the two sessions nightly, we don't half fill one session, so why should we put it on for two sessions?
In Sydney, small operators have joined forces against big-time film distributors. They claim the multiplex cinemas are the driving force, determined to push small operators out of the projection room, out of business, and fast.
Hey, let's get an idea on Dr. Rishkoff. She was with him at the lecture this afternoon. She was trying to tell him something.
Nowadays, the likes of Redford and Roberts perform in multi-screen complexes. Hollywood's brightest stars keep on playing, but for the old suburban picture palaces that nursed them to fame, a final curtain call is looming. Sadly, after these performances, there'll be no standing ovation, no encore.
That's where it gets into an interesting argument. Does society owe the old one-screen cinemas a life?
We'll be right back. 1939, when humanity is for the second time in 25 years teetering on the brink of a world war. Europe was in a state of flux as Hitler prepared to invade Poland. Britain's Neville Chamberlain says it will never happen. His slogan, "Peace in our time," goes down in history as one of the biggest blunders of the 20th century. The other side of the world, all that was a long way from people's minds. Despite the fact Australia was caught deep in its worst ever drought, it was still riding on the back of the sheep towards prosperity. And in Perth, at Mount Lawley, a new cinema was opening, the Astor. The new picture house was built on the foundations of an old Victorian music hall, but you'd never have guessed it. Gone were the ageing trappings of the period which bore the old Queen's name. They were replaced by the ultra-modern decorations of some newfangled design called Art Deco. And no doubt, for years the old cinema enjoyed huge popularity, showing some of the greats of the time.
Hush, hush, sweet Charlotte. Charlotte, don't you cry. Hush, hush, sweet Charlotte. I'll love you till I die.
Peyton Place. The town everyone's talking about.
But over recent years, what once stood proudly on the corner of Beaufort and Walcott Street has become a shadow of its former self, showing signs of age and neglect. To say the Astor Cinema Mount Lawley has seen better days is an understatement. But earlier this year, things began to change. The lease to the old picture house was taken on by Entrevision, and a new Astor began to take place. Ron Regan is the man behind Entrevision, and it's been a lifelong ambition of his to operate a cinema, to show the sorts of movies that don't get shown anymore.
I guess ultimately I've always wanted to run a cinema that I could put a product in that I like, and if possible, an Art Deco picture palace type operation. That's something I've always wanted to do, even though I recognise that, you know, the commercial realities are that it's not always easy to pull off.
Mm. But to take on something particularly as run down as this would have to be a very brave thing to do.
Yes, I think a lot of my peers, so to speak, in the cinema game would look at me and think that there's an interesting mental paraplegic, to use my terminology, and why go to all this trouble? I mean, the cinema is basically operable, if tatty. Why go to all the expense? That's not my style. I like to get in there and run a thing very well. From a quality angle, I believe there is room in Perth for such a cinema, and that's what I'm trying to do here.
But before the silver screen could come to life again, the old lady had to be gutted and virtually rebuilt. It was 50 years ago this year the old picture house was given a new lease on life. Its Art Deco design knocked them dead, but now those contrasting colours and intricate plasterwork have either faded or have been painted over. But the characters still remains hidden underneath the dirt and grime. The beauty which once had audiences marvelling was still there, just waiting to be born again. The man with the job of resurrecting the soul of the Astor is Philip McAllister.
It is a challenge, particularly in this instance because of the time involved. We have a fairly short time to transform the cinema from a fairly tired and old cinema to a new one.
I'm feeling the cracks that ran through the door and kept my mind from wandering.
I see our role, particularly one of reinterpreting what was here, but in the sense of the 1980s. You know, it'll definitely be a Art Deco cinema, but at the same time, it'll be a cinema that's obviously of our period as well.
Once the Astor's facelift is complete, it will be Perth's equivalent to Melbourne's Astor, showing first release art movies, midnight cult films, and of course, the classics.
But Ron, we've seen the closure of drive-ins and other cinemas just going to the wall. We're in the age of the video, so why bother?
Very true. So, as some people say, well, look, you know, again, that's the way it's heading. Why do this? Again, you see, I believe that there's a trend back to cinema, because there's no question the best way to see a film is on a big screen, uninterrupted. Now, admittedly, some people, the Teeny Bopper film, I'm not interested particularly in showing it here, and anyway, that's as good on a video as anywhere else. But, for example, Gone with the Wind is a different story. I think it's far more effective on a big screen and without commercials than on video or television.
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
Ron says Art Deco is part of Australia's movie history and has become his cross to save at least one.
Basically, what we're trying to achieve is a total restoration of the building. Almost every aspect to be revamped. That means new screens, curtains, projectors, sound equipment. Totally repainted, redecorated, highlighting all the ornate features of the building.
I suppose we have had a couple of interesting discoveries. One that particularly comes to mind is just, if you like, a reaffirmation of what we're saying about reinterpretation. We've took down a couple of screens in the foyer which would have been covered for a number of years and found some of the original paint colours which were greens and pinks, and sort of that fits in very well with what we're doing here and reinterpreting those colours.
New carpets, new seating upstairs, air conditioning into the upstairs lounge area, opening the lounge area hopefully and differentiating pricing between the stalls and the lounge, establishing a fairly nice lobby upstairs with a cafe and where people can relax and have a coffee or something before or after the show. Quite tasteful but extensive neoning of the external side, the externals of the building. We're really, you know, totally going through the whole place and redoing it.
Cost you a pretty penny.
Yes, it's costing me an arm and some legs. There's no question about that.
In fact, the cost to restore the Astor will top the $500,000 mark. So how will Entravision get a return for its money?
And although there may be a degree of the heart involved in the exercise, the fact remains I'm not about to do this to become a bankrupt. My idea would be to, I believe in cinema should be there and used, so I will be trying to have it open as much as I can. I will be quite happy to get out there and try and encourage clubs, senior citizens, schools to use the place during the day, bulk bookings at discount prices. I'm quite happy to perhaps run midnight shows. I think there's a market for that here, quality but cult films in the midnight. And a selection of films at so-called peak times, and that could be art first releases, it could be repertory, bringing back previously released films which are of interest, or possibly even the occasional mainstream.
And now all their dreaming is a reality. The final touches have been made, and at last the cinema is finished and ready for the big opening night. And that came on July the 26th, 1989, 50 years after its last refurbishment. Hundreds of Perth's VIPs were invited to the grand opening, and a preview of the movie The Dead Poets Society, starring Robin Williams. Among those invited was a couple whose first date was at the cinema 50 years ago.
I think they've done a magnificent job tonight, looking round. You know, the colour's beautiful. It's modern colours, but it's still nice and soft and most attractive. It's a credit to the architect and everybody associated with it, as I'm concerned.
And those sentiments were echoed by everyone else who attended.
Absolutely, it's wonderful. Had a good look round and very, very impressed indeed, Mike.
I think it's fantastic to see the way this this cinema's been done up so beautifully. It really is it's a credit to Ron, the work he's done, and to all the movie lovers in Perth. It'll be a great pleasure.
Have you had a good look round?
Yes, absolutely wonderful. Yes, I think it's absolutely lovely.
I've got to say that I'm very excited about the development. We look for entertainment for the kids and for ourselves, and I think this is a great opportunity.
Are you a fan of Art Deco?
I'm a fan of films, and my credentials in that area go back to the University Film Society and the establishment of the International Film Theatre. So I'm a film buff, and I'm really delighted to have it as a local cinema.
Right, but we're living in the age of the video. Do you think Ron is sort of going the right way?
I mean, I think it's the same argument as computers suggesting that people will work from home. The fact is we're really social animals, and I'm sure that we enjoy congregating together to enjoy entertainment, and that's what we're going to get here tonight, and I'm really thrilled about that.
So you think it's going to work?
I think it's going to work, and I've congratulated him already on its success. I think it'll be an undoubted success and a real valuable addition to this area and to Perth.
But what of Ron Regan himself? Was it all worth it?
Oh yes, I think ultimately I'll be very pleased that we've done it and pulled it off. And but I'm such a person who accepts such high standards that, you know, I'm not happy until I deliver the product on the screen as well. And of course, there's a lot of things that can go wrong there.
And apart from a few hiccups, nothing did go wrong.
With your indulgence, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to cut the ribbon. Thank you. Thank you.
I want you to go too with me on the choo-choo. The days here to get near, see what I have to say. Get your stuff and pack up, cause we're going away. The sun shines, my heart pines for those lasses and canes. You know that it tastes good, we're down in the cane brace. Forget cares and let go of your troubles and blues. Let's be gay on our way, let's get on the choo-choo. Take your places for the first luncheon, please. Pass right forward. Premier service. Prenez vos places, monsieur, mesdames, s'il vous plaît. Vite à guest, vite à chien. Thank you.
come to me in my gondola, waiting on the old lagoon. Serenade across the water. Can you hear it soft and low?
Thank you. David Coulthard in Brazil. The fair thing along too, but officials found this thing the differences from standard by the Elf Company before the season. Gerhard Berger now takes the race point for Ferrari, ahead of McLaren's Mika Hakkinen, with Lotus teammate John Alesi third on a hit attack on a Crystal Palace fan last January. Italian giants into Milan is a positive club.
Looking at the west east, to Tasmania as well, with the grey and visible back, and the beauty for the south between the foot back in Tassie Island, and indeed there is a wall of the coast, which is up the coast of New South Wales, more chance of storm down the northeast of New South Wales, southeast of Queensland, then thinning out of the Atlantic coast as well. The tropics are scattered to the activity on those lines.
Something to see, and this year is no exception.
Something to believe.
And it really is wonderful just to see so many of you here this morning. I know many of you are viewers from 94.5, and congratulations. And of course, invited guests from Channel 9. This is a really special time of the year for everyone here at Channel 9, and certainly for 94.5. One big year, the 67th Academy Awards. And
thank you. Thank you.